Ryan and Reverend Bill. So let's welcome Roth.
Yes, love is my decision. It's up to me to dance down that row. And as we weave together in unity and love, celebrate this week in Australia. The week coming up is Harmony Week. Good morning. Harmony Week is a celebration that recognises our diversity and brings together Australians from all different backgrounds. It's about inclusiveness, respect, and a sense of belonging for everyone. Harmony Week is celebrated during the week from Monday to Sunday. That includes the 21st of March, so it starts tomorrow. The 21st of March is also the United Nations International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination and for All Discrimination. This year's theme is Everyone Belongs in Australia, a theme we might well embrace in unity as we open to include people of all faiths or none, people from any cultural background. Ours is an inclusive community. Now, to complicate things, Victoria's Cultural Diversity Week actually started on the 11th, a week ago, just opened. It's Cultural Diversity Week. It goes through to the 21st of March. So there's an overlap between Victoria and the whole of Australia. Since it's already started, City of Whitehorse will be holding its celebration for Harmony Day this afternoon. The occasion is marked by a free concert this afternoon, bringing together people of many different backgrounds together to share their cultures. On their website, City of Whitehorse has written, come and enjoy powerful First Nations singer and musician Mitch Tambo on stage, supported by high energy African Super Monday percussion group and the mind blowing lion dancers from Ungai Aushu. Everyone belongs at our Free Harmony Day concert, and we want to see you there celebrating our community and enjoying live music, workshops and activities, food trucks and dance performance. There'll be foods from all different cultures going on past events. Make a seed bomb, paint your part in the migratory wall mural. Watch and taste. Watch and taste some cooking demonstrations and witness the beautiful dances from the Victoria Huaxin Chinese Community Association. And you can also take a tour of Strathdown House itself and the surrounding gardens. The timetable hasn't translated from PowerPoint to the map very well, but there's a printed copy over on the prayer table if you'd like to have a look and decide whether you'd like to go to all or part of the afternoon's performances today. Topping the bill is Mitch Tanberg, who won Australia's Got Talent in 2019 with this. That's just the start of his performance of Johnny Pham's You're the Voice in his Ganilaray language. We are all part of each other. We're all someone's daughter, someone's son. Those are the words of the song. And this is Stan Grant. In his recent book, Australia Day, Jeanette and I belong to a group that's currently studying the book. So haven't read it all yet, by any means, but he's attempting to reconcile the opposing views of Australia Day or Invasion Day and the different sides. And he makes a very good go at it. I think he offers a unifying solution should look forward to. In it he writes, change wherever it occurs is often accompanied by tragedy. Think of the refugee setting out on a leaky boat, leaving behind her land and family, likely never to see them again. Think of the convict in chains, sent to a land he'd never heard of, with no prospect of return. This is the story of our world. There is not a people on our planet who have not at some time endured revolution, war, invasion, or persecution. It is happening in our time as we see the greatest forced movement of people since the end of World War II. And while he's writing about the debates surrounding Australia Day, much of it is relevant to all of us. But looking through his family history, on both sides, both European and Indigenous, Wiradjuri in his case, he concludes, we are, all of us, part of each other. He sees in his lineage noblemen and thieves. But here at Unity, we can celebrate Harmony Week. Unity, we recognize the oneness of all with the divine, and therefore our oneness with one another. We have been enriched here by people from many different cultural backgrounds. And so we know with certainty that we are indeed, all of us, a part of each other. So let us be aware of this variety of cultural tones in our world, weaving together to enrich all of us and have a happy Harmony Week.
Let's thank Rock one more time. And now let's welcome Lorraine. No, it's okay. Morning, everyone, and to those on Zoom as well. So Reverend Bill asked me to give my perspective of how I see as a migrant in Australia and what this means to me. I just thought I'll do a little bit of research. And there are some fascinating statistics about Australia's diversity that can be good conversation starters. So they say we are home to the world's continuous cultures, as well as Australians who identify with more than 300 ancestries. Since 1945, over 7.5 million people have migrated to Australia. Nearly half, 49%, of Australians were born overseas or have at least one parent who was. 85% of Australians agree multiculturalism has been good for Australia. Apart from English, the most common languages spoken in Australia are Mandarin, Arabic, Cantonese, Vietnamese, Italian, Greek, Tagalog or Filipino, Hindi, Spanish, and Punjabi. More than 70 indigenous languages are spoken in Australia. That's quite amazing. So these facts are taken from the Australian Bureau of Statistics 2016 census data. So I didn't make it up. So Harmony Day was first celebrated in Australia in apparently 1999, and March 21 is known as Harmony Day in kicking off Harmony Week, where individuals are encouraged to share and celebrate their cultural identities. It's a week where people across Australia bring traditional dishes to share at school or work while wearing colourful clothes. So I often think about what it is that makes Australia such a popular destination that people put their lives at risk to get here, and why I chose to migrate to Australia. For me, it was a choice. Well, I already had close family here who migrated in the late 1960s. That was a very big incentive. I got the opportunity to spend 3 months holiday in 1979 and see what the country and life here offered. I returned to Sri Lanka at the end of those 3 months with mixed feelings and wasn't sure if I really wanted to make a permanent move. While I was here, I was encouraged to stay on past my 3 months and see if I could, and I wasn't prepared to do that because I had parents back in Sri Lanka. However, after going back and after a few years, I finally decided to migrate and was granted a visa as a permanent resident. And upon arriving here, it didn't take me long to assimilate into the Australian way of life. With English as a first language, it made it much easier. My parents and I didn't migrate as a family. We did actually apply in 1974, but didn't quite make it for various, because there was the, I think there was a policy on where I think it was not white collar workers, because my parents were both white collar workers. The preference was given to skilled migration, even though we had family here, so we didn't qualify at the time. But my parents followed 8 years later and have settled in really well, even though they were well into their 60s. So I believe as a migrant, I have a responsibility to integrate into the community and the country that I now call home. I often hear migrants who have lived here for 40, 50 years say, back home we did this, or back home we had that, or I'm going back home for a holiday. I find these statements quite interesting and fascinating, in fact. So what does it take to call a country your home? I've been very blessed to work for companies that celebrate the cultural diversity of its staff. We have people from many cultural backgrounds, and we work well as a team, as the business has a very good culture. We are encouraged to celebrate our diversity and connect with one another through morning teas and other group activities. Although Australia is a multicultural country, how much do we actually know about the other cultures and the communities around us? How much do we participate in some of these activities? We can be hesitant and fearful when we are dealing with what's unknown. But I think these celebrations with the multicultural week, I think the one that started in Victoria the week before, plus Harmony Week, it gives us the opportunity to celebrate our cultural diversity by living the Harmony Week message that everyone belongs in workplaces, in our community, in schools, there are sporting groups, local councils, and state governments. And that way we promote our values of respect, equality, and freedom, and connect communities through a sense of belonging. So here at Unity, we've always been inclusive of everyone, all cultures, religions. So I feel I belong very well in at Unity. So whenever I travel overseas, which I've done a fair bit, it's always lovely to go and see other countries and how people live and explore other cultures. But when I return home from every overseas trip, we touch down very safely at Tullamarine, the first thing that comes to my mind is, it's really good to be back home. And that is even when I go to Sri Lanka and come back, I always say, it's good to be back home. Because I know that this is where I belong. Thank you.
Let's thank Lorraine one more time. Thank you. Lorraine, that really resonates. Thank you. As a migrant myself, it took my family 11 years of trying to get a visa. And because my parents wouldn't bribe the authorities in India, we could have got it in 6 months, but no, they wouldn't do that. So it took 11 years and we had to come in on the family reunification visa because my dad's sister was here at the time and sponsored us. Anyway, I'm an Aussie through and through. That's all good. So, and now it's time for the one, the only, Robin Bell.
Thank you, Wendy. And thank you, Lorraine, and also to Rod. It's a fascinating time, and the subject is harmony. And not necessarily as far as different groups go, but harmony amongst ourselves, which is when we're all settled down, we buy a house, you never know who your neighbour's going to be till after a certain amount of time. And so that's where the unity principles come in handy. So I was born in Glasgow. I am half Scottish, a quarter Irish, and a quarter Spanish, according to my lot. And I wouldn't know who they were. My father came out here in 1950. He got married, I think, 1946, and I was born, and I didn't see him till I was three. He came out here from Glasgow, and he built a house for us, and we sailed on one of those P&O liners. And funny enough, at my early age, I can still remember seeing the flying fish. And little things stick out in your mind. And then, of course, we crossed the equator, and I didn't know who it was, and I saw this man covered in blood. It was Santa Claus. No one told me that any of that stuff. And my father could hardly wait to get out of Glasgow. There were bombs across the Clyde River. It was an ammunition factory, and it wasn't a very pleasant place. And they were actually in Great Depression, probably up until the middle of the 50s, I'd say. And isn't it interesting? The coronation, 1953, was supposed to bring everyone alive, and I think it sort of helped. And here we are again, 70 years later, another coronation. What'll that do this time? Anyway, when black and white television came in, at the end of it, they used to play God Save the Queen. And here's the Queen looking very glamorous, side saddle on a horse, saluting. And my mother stood up and my father said, sit down. Because we're home, who's going to know we're standing up? And so, you know, we had a little bit of adjustments to do. And the other thing I had to adapt to, with my school friends, I had an accent like Billy Connolly. And so, I didn't actually, till later. And I remember bringing my first friend home, and my mother, I took him through the house, and we went into the kitchen, and we had dirty shoes on. And my mother says, "You need going through the hoose." And the kid said, "What?" I said, "We're not allowed through the house." And I remember going back to school the next day, and the kid says, "Through the hoose, through the hoose, through the hoose." So that's why I speak like I do. And I go to the States the first time I did 2014 was the first time I was overseas. And that's when I first met Reverend Donna Christine. And I remember thinking, my goodness, people thought I was from Britain. No, I was outraged. So, but I did explain that we don't all speak like Paul Hogan. And some people do. And but, you know, life goes on. And the other big thing I had to get used to, of course, was football. My father played soccer, which was a no-no. And they had a soccer team with some Italians, some Dutch, some Scottish and some Irish, but no Aussies. And they'd meet in their own back oval somewhere and play, and you get the people driving past saying, "Play a real game," and all this sort of stuff. But anyway, the Northwest Coast was a wonderfully enriching area. We had the Dutch Reformed Church and the Dutch butchers, who were very famous along the coast, and we had Italians and quite a few other nationalities as well. No Indigenous people. I didn't see an Indigenous person until I was probably about 10, which is strange, because that part of Tasmania, especially going down to Deloraine, was the scene of some terrible stuff that we're only just now starting to take in and understand what happened. And you even drive past Deloraine without even knowing. You think, oh, this is terrible, a bit like people who go to Port Arthur. So that was just one of those things. And I just settled in quite well. And my mother, being Scottish, she used to sing Scottish songs dressed in a kilt. And we had a group called the Penguin Fun Follies. And before television, they would tour all around the Northwest Coast and money for charity every Monday night. And she'd sing songs like I Love a Lassie. And nowadays, you'd think you don't sing songs like that. And sort of, you know, the times have changed, but no one cared. And things, some of those old Scottish songs about drinking past midnight and all those Scottish wonderful songs from Harry Lauder, Stop Your Ticklin' Jock was another one. And I used to be so embarrassed. But anyway, she got a round of applause for it, and it was part of my upbringing. So just to check before we finish this talk, what is harmony? Well, a couple of definitions. The state of being in agreement. And another one here, the qualities of forming a pleasing and constant whole. Now, we've got to be careful here, because we like to be in harmony, but it's too easy when we're in harmony to get into the comfort zone. And we all know what it's like when we're not in harmony. And sometimes we need a little bit of stirring up for us to appreciate what we already have. And the verse in Genesis 31, and God saw everything it had made, and behold, it was very good, like the Garden of Eden. And we won't go into what God is. God is what your conception of it is. And that's, if that works for you, that's fine. But so everything was made for us. Look at it, this abundant universe. And we have to live in harmony with it. And make sure that we do, because that's one of our biggest lessons. Usually we learn harmony through trial and error when we start. But if we've got any sort of inward appreciation of life, we realize that, yes, those spiritual laws always work. We don't get punished by the law. We get punished because of us not being in form with it. The basic rule is, of course, the golden rule, do unto others as you would be done by. Yogananda wrote, within your physical form is a secret door to divinity. Isn't that lovely? Within your physical form, our body temple, is that door to our divinity. And he goes on to say, hasten your evolution. This is so good. By proper diet, healthful living, and reverence for your body as a temple of God. So I'll leave that with you as we move on to the next step. So thank you very much.